Hey everyone, you are listening to episode 11 of the Casual Historian Podcast. In this episode, my co-host James and I talk about Brexit and its greater historical context. Because as it turns out, it didn't come out of nowhere. If you enjoy this episode, then I would ask that you give the show a rating and a review on iTunes. Sharing the existence of this podcast on social media would also be greatly appreciated. If you want more content like this, then you can go to casualhistorian.com, where I publish more history-related content. But for now, onto our regularly scheduled program.
Ah, so, long time no see.
Grant, it has really been a long time. Made only longer by the fact that after recording our last episode, the world went completely insane.
Well, I don't think anything happened in that last month. I mean, I think the internet agreed to just ignore that year entirely. You know, did you survive the great meme war of 2016?
The memes weren't even the worst thing about last year.
Well, I don't think anyone can act surprised when we spent the entire year mourning a gorilla.
For the record, I really didn't care about the gorilla. I didn't vote for the gorilla. I'm one of those people that didn't vote for the gorilla. But yeah, it's the thing is, though, we are living, for better or worse, and so far a lot of it worse, in momentous times. And it's times like these that it's really important for us to reflect on where we have been, you know, that old adage. But I think that especially not just with the U.S. presidential election, but the Brexit vote, there's a lot we can see that we could have seen coming and probably should have, but hindsight is 2020.
Well, I guess we should really talk about, where does Brexit fit into this long run of British history? Is it some kind of aberration, or is it a natural move for the Brits to make?
Well, I think that there are arguments for either side of that, honestly. And I think a big part of it is that the Brexit vote is really just another iteration of Britain's very complicated relationship with the rest of Europe, historically, especially within the last two centuries, even going back a little bit further.
I have to say, given my own personal political persuasions, if I were a Brit during that vote, I probably would have voted to exit, but I would probably interpret the entirety of British history with that mindset as the entire history of Britain and European relations is Europe is constantly trying to make Britain part of the continent and Britain doesn't want to be part of the continent.
Well, I think that is partially true. I think there is something of an oversimplification there. There has never been a time, really, when Britain has not had commitments on the continent of Europe, be it the old Angevin Empire, where, you know, they controlled, you know, much of France up to the Hundred Years' War in Normandy and Aquitaine. Still, technically speaking, the territories of Jersey and Guernsey, the Channel Islands, and Gibraltar mean that Britain has commitments on the continent. But it's less about the continent having one will, because I think something else that the Brits are cleanly aware of is that there is not really a singular will on the continent at present. But Britain has long played the role of seeing the continent as a place of many, many competing interests. And so much for much of its history, it pursued what was called balance of power politics, usually allying with a weaker power against a strong power. Usually that strong power was France. Usually.
They dropped the ball in the last couple centuries. Like the British haven't needed to team up with someone against France since Napoleon.
Right. And in fact, France ended up becoming Britain's teammate after German unification. But the British approach to Europe has been that Britain has interests in the continent for the reasons I've mentioned earlier, but also because it's just the geographic proximity. Britain may be an island, but continental trade is very important to the Brits.
Well, when you are an island, it has no choice but to be important. Boats are a thing. That's what they've been good at for as long as they've needed to be good at it. Mm-hmm. And one of the many questions that needs to be asked about this is, are the British Europeans? I mean, I think if you asked a lot of these very pro-Brexit people, they would say that, no, we're not Europeans. We are different. You know, in the same way Americans would say, we are not like the Brits or not like the rest of Western civilization.
Right. Well, I mean, many, many cultures have their own pretenses at exceptionalism. But I do, I will say this, though, that in the Brexit camp, both those for Brexit and those for remaining in the European Union, the question of a European identity did cut swathes across society in the UK. And there are Brexiteers who do consider themselves to be Europeans, and many of them have emphasized that the vote to leave the European Union, which is a political and economic organization, is not a vote to leave Europe. One, that is geologically impossible because you can't simply move an island yet. And also, it's simply the shared history, culture, economic and trade ties, even outside of the European Union, means that Britain is an is a European nation. That also applies to linguistics. English is a West Saxon dialect, so it's very much part of the Indo-European family of languages. Same thing for the Celtic languages spoken in the UK. We also see that there is a larger question, not merely of European identity, but it also affects British identity. 6 years ago, well, a little more than 6 years ago, when Gordon Brown was Prime Minister, Brown and New Labour, they were in government, really tried to push the notion of a British identity. That failed. People still primarily will identify themselves as English or Scottish or Welsh or Northern Irish. As a statement of identity, British is properly just a nationality. It's not an identity. And I think that in many ways that is somewhat reflecting the tension between am I a European or not, which is a question that many Brits ask themselves during the referendum period.
A big part of British identity for a long time has usually been built on not what they are, but by what they are not. Like when we saw the Acts of Union between England and Scotland, to be British was to not be Catholic, and then later to not be French. And I guess you could say, if we were to take this into the 21st century, to be British is to not be European, whatever that means.
Well, I suppose that there might be a shifting identities and concepts like that do shift over time. I would say that when New Labour was promoting the notion of a British identity, it was a Britain in Europe. New Labour was very much a pro-European political force. And that's also something that I think we'll probably get to later, was how historically and even recently, all of the major parties of the United Kingdom were pro-European.
Yes, definitely that, though. I guess that whole election was a bit of a mess because only two of the political parties were actually able to take firm positions on the debate. Like, the SNP and UKIP were the only ones who were actually able to take official positions while everyone else was sort of, what do we do? Like the Conservatives, like, we need to appease the UKIP voters we promised a referendum to.
Yeah, I think that we'll probably get a bit more into the political dimension of it later, but you did have some parties that had very clear, unambiguous positions on the European Union. You had, for a national party, you had the Liberal Democrats, who were have historically been the most ardently pro-European party in the UK. You also had, like you mentioned, the SNP, the other national parties like Plaid Cymru in Wales, the SDLP in Northern Ireland, and Sinn Féin are very pro-European. Then you had more Eurosceptic. You had soft Euroscepticism in Labour and the Tories. You had hard Euroscepticism in UKIP. Yeah. But, you know, when we do think about the effects of identity and what the EU, what the future relationship between the EU and the UK is going to be like, a lot of it we have to look back at what it was like before the UK joined the EU. Because, you know, what many Americans might not know is that the UK was not a founding member of the European Union or its predecessor, the European Communities or the European Economic Area.
That gets me into one of the thoughts I had. One of the big areas of, I'm not sure if contention is the right word, but one of the issues that we had in our own U.S. election was trade, free trade being a big issue. And that, of course, was something of an issue in the Brexit vote, and that you do have a number of protectionists coming up now. And I find within that debate, I found that there was a bit of miscategorization is the right word, but basically I think people were misportraying what the trade relationship between the UK, the EU, and all the other EU members actually was. Because the biggest thing is that when they voted against it, all the critics of the Brexit vote described it as leaving a free trade zone, but Britain, to enter that free trade zone, was required to abandon another free trade area. The EU was not a, you know, is not, I should say, in case this is predictive, but it's not a free trade zone. It's a customs union.
And it's both. So there is the European Customs Union, and there's also the common market, which is the free trade area. And what defines the free trade area is that there is an invisible barrier, a tariff barrier, for non-EU trade, excepting in cases where the EU has relationships, trading relationships with those countries. Referring to the free trade area that Britain left in the 1970s in order to join the European Union's predecessor, the European Free Trade Area, or EFTA, the other members of EFTA, with only two exceptions, no, I'm sorry, three exceptions, have all become part of the EU, because the other members of EFTA included Norway, Iceland, Switzerland, Denmark, oh, and Ireland. When the UK entered the EU, it was joined by Denmark and by Ireland. Norway was going to, Norway decided not to at the last moment due to a political change, but in the intervening years, Switzerland, Norway, and Iceland have all created, all have membership and access to the single market through agreements with the EU. They simply do not function as part of the EU's political structure.
That's not really the free trade area I was talking about. Before then, they had more or less a free trade agreement with their former colonies. They used to engage in free trade with Canada, New Zealand, Australia, all their former colonies, or most of their former colonies. But when they joined the EEC, they were forced to give up all of that other trade.
Well, I think that it's important to remember that Britain's economic position in the 1970s was abysmal. And it actually is probably the worst post-war economic crisis in terms of the human impact. By the numbers, the 2008 crisis was certainly worse, but in terms of how it actually impacted the people and the structures and institutions of the UK, the 1970s were far worse. And one of the things we saw there was actually a major decline in trade with the Commonwealth realms and former colonies, because supply lines do matter. You know, when the largest economies in the Commonwealth outside of the UK, nations like Canada, Australia, New Zealand, at the time, South Africa still, as well as India and Pakistan, they're very, very far away. And now that the Brits didn't have Suez, it also meant that maintaining these trade arrangements was expensive. In the case of Canada, for example, they have a much larger market partner right next door, far smaller supply chain. In the case of Australia, there's China and Japan and the East Asian markets. The same thing for India. So when we look at the abandonment of one free trade area, free trade arrangements within the old empire, the old Commonwealth, Europe was a much more lucrative market because it could be more efficient by being able to export to something just across a swimmable channel, I mean, if you're really athletic, versus transatlantic or trade across the entire planet. And I do think, however, that you raise an interesting point. Barbara Castle, who was a well-known labor cabinet minister during the last time they had a referendum on EU membership, she was very much a socialist and very much an anti-European Union figure, and she'd argued against membership of the European Economic Area because of the historical and economic links with the old colonies. But again, empire had collapsed. The major realms like Canada, Australia, New Zealand had been moving moving in other directions for over a decade by that point.
Let's go back or sideways or however we want to describe it to, I think you were talking about this before we started this conversation of wanting to talk about the post-Napoleonic relationship between the UK and the rest of Europe and how that built to the current situation we are in now.
I'm not the only person who looks back at the Napoleonic era and its aftermath for inspiration here. Boris Johnson, the current Foreign and Commonwealth Secretary, as well as a leading Brexiteer, compared the EU to Napoleon, I think very unfairly. But Napoleon, of course, had dominated European politics for nearly 20 years in some form or other, and he brought Europe to its knees before Europe finally got its act together and exiled him twice. But the settlement of the Napoleonic Wars really set the international order in Europe, and by an extent the rest of the world because of colonialism, for the next 100 years. Britain was one of the guarantors of the Congress of Vienna, alongside other major powers like the Russian Empire, the Kingdom of Prussia, the Austrian Empire, and France, in whatever governmental form it had that decade. But Britain's participation in the Concert of Europe did not really last long for several reasons. One was that Britain and shortly afterward France represented a kind of liberal strain of government. You know, they were constitutionalists. They believed in non-absolute monarchies. Gradually, democracy was expanding in their territories, whereas the Concert of Europe was hamstrung on the other side by the very reactionary, conservative, authoritarian, monarchic ideals in the quote-unquote Holy Alliance, which featured Prussia, Austria, and Russia. Then, of course, we have the dynastic change in the 1830s when Queen Victoria becomes queen. This is significant for several reasons. One is it severs the union that had existed between between the United Kingdom and the Kingdom of Hanover, which had been in place in varying forms the last better part of 100 years. It also, which removed Britain's last large-scale continental commitment. The revolutions that swept Europe in the 1830s and in 1848 also kind of isolated Britain to an extent, because Britain didn't experience these revolutions. The clamorings and that the rebels had across Europe in these occasions were actually like, we want what Britain has. We want rule of law. We don't want arbitrary decisions from a monarch. Also, we saw the growth of the prime minister as the chief architect of all aspects of policy in the UK. And during the 19th century, Britain had what was called splendid isolation, in which it was much more concerned with its colonies overseas than it was with what was going on in the continent, for better or worse, because Britain largely was missing in action when things like the Franco-Prussian War took place, or earlier than that, the Brothers' War. So there were major shifts that took place in the continent while Britain was not looking, for lack of a better expression. Britain did start looking after Germany unified, but by then it was because of the shift in the balance of power. As long as Germany was disunited, the strongest continental power was France. Germany united, it was, and has been ever since, the strongest continental power. And so then we saw a kind of resurgence of British balance of power politics. When Germany began building a navy ostensibly to rival Britain's. Britain allied with France and Russia, two other powers who were threatened by Germany. And of course, this all sets the stage for the nightmare that was World War One.
So they very clearly have a long and sticky relationship with Europe. They definitely seem like they want to keep an arm's length away from it, while at the same time telling them what to do.
Yeah, the British relationship with Europe does have a lot of contradictions and historical oddities to it. World War One, because of this, the scale of the devastation, we don't often remember this in the United States because we were such latecomers to the war that it didn't really impact us. Pretty much the biggest impact World War One had on the American mind was the Lusitania. But in Britain, in the case throughout Europe, there were entire villages that had just had entire generations of young men dead, just gone. And their survivors were dissipate, cynical, despairing. It was called the Lost Generation. But in the interest of trying to prevent another continental war, Britain, alongside France, and also due to the fall of the Russian Empire to Bolshevism becoming the Soviet Union, became the guarantors, basically, of the Versailles Peace in Europe. Very imperfectly, because the Versailles Peace was not designed to create peace, in spite of the creation of the League of Nations. It was also not tenable, because though Britain and France reached the apex of their power after World War One, they were already exhausted. And the decline was already setting in for them. So when we get to World War II, we have Britain and France once again marching together in defense of continental order, but at huge cost. And so by World War II, the peoples of Europe, or at least Central and Western Europe, had had enough. It had enough. Two major wars within a lifetime was too much. And the collective will was that it can't happen again. And this is where the mindset that lays the foundation for the major international organizations of our day lay. That's where we get the United Nations, where we get the IMF, where we get NATO, where we get the European Union.
Would you blame the fact that World War One was capable of happening because the British decided not to be involved in Europe beforehand?
Yes, I would. And a big part of that was that there were several occasions during the shakeups that took place, leading to German unification, for example, in which European powers like France and others appealed to the Brits to act as arbiters. And the Brits simply were not interested. And they did not pay attention until it was too late to prevent it. Had the Brits been adhering to their more traditional foreign policy before the Napoleonic Wars, they would have come to France's aid during the Franco-Prussian War, simply because it was obvious to most people that France was too weak on its own to defeat the armies of the German Confederation.
Did the French ever ask the British for help during that, or the French being very, well, French about it?
They actually had asked for help. Napoleon III, for all of his many, many faults, was an Anglophile, and he actually did try to cultivate better relations with the United Kingdom. In fact, he went into exile there when he was deposed. But his efforts would later bear fruit by the Third Republic, which continued that policy of aligning with Britain, partly because the Third Republic, which was born as the Germans were besieging Paris during the Franco-Prussian War, never really managed to let go of their resentment for the outcome of the Franco-Prussian War.
We asked this question before, the question of, If the British are Europeans, we're the British, but I guess what does it actually mean to be a European other than a political and geographic union?
Well, for that, I will look at for starters at the great post-war leaders of the UK. The post-World War II leaders of the UK, in terms of how they viewed Europe. Churchill famously described the notion of a United States of Europe. That Europe would eventually come together. And the idea that, especially in Central and Western Europe, that there was enough shared history, shared tradition, and a commitment to maintaining peace, that that was feasible. But neither Winston Churchill, who was a conservative, nor his successor as Prime Minister, Clement Attlee, who was a Labour Party politician, neither of them saw Britain's role in a political union of Europe. They saw Britain's role as being outside of the political union, but closely linked to it. And so they both viewed Britain as being a European country. Linguistically, religiously, culturally, historically, Britain's shared history. In fact, even the notion of a British identity in opposition to European identity is because of Europe.
Well, that's more in general how they... British identity is always formed as in opposition to something else because, well, we can't be the same as the Scots.
Well, that would be an English identity versus a... Yeah, because British identity includes the Scots. I wish the S&P would remember that, but...
Yeah. Well, I find the situation of those who actually refer to themselves as being British in the UK, it's similar to in the United States, those who refer to themselves as just being Americans. Right, it's like the people in the United States who refer to themselves as just as Americans tend to be those of European descent, while those who are not of European descent always qualify it with some hyphenated thing. And I think in the UK, it's probably similar in that the only people in the UK who identify as British are the English.
And not really specifically the English. It's more cosmopolitan peoples, for example, like in the great city, like London, Manchester, Birmingham, you know, the larger cities, in the shires, they're very much English still. And I think that that's actually something interesting, too, because the notion of identity in the UK is an amalgamation of at least four different countries, all of which had their own identities and histories leading up to union. Whereas in the U.S., the colonies did not have really a strong sense of their own identity, except if you were from like a major colony like New York or Virginia. But you know, who ever heard, and I'm sorry if I offend anybody with this, but who ever heard of someone fervently professing their Rhode Islander identity?
Actually, that's actually probably the weird exception to what you're thinking, because they are one of the weird who would emphasize their Rhode Island identity because they're
Fair enough. How about Delawareans or whatever the demonym for Delaware is? You know, the many of the smaller colonies simply were subsumed into the American concept, and of course, you know, there's a bit more of this kind of sense of identity in places like Texas or California or Hawaii, which due to their history or size or significance or any combination of those two have an identity. But overarchingly, America, you're an American first, and your state is usually secondary, if not incidental. In the UK, it's the opposite. You're English, you're Welsh, you're Scottish, you're Northern Irish, or you're Irish trapped under English oppression. That's the other thing, too. In the US, no one state dominates or has dominated the U.S. ever. In the U.K., it has always clearly been a union dominated and driven by England. It is geographically the largest of its component parts. It is the most populous. It is the most economically developed. So in some parts of the U.K., like Scotland, parts of Wales, Northern Ireland, the notion of a British identity is greeted with some skepticism because it is seen as a kind of submission to English tyranny.
Yeah. I remember seeing the maps from that Brexit vote, and you see, you know, it's a lot of, you know, basically in England, everyone outside of London, and then you have, like, for some reason, Wales all wanting to Brexit, while the Scots in London...
And Northern Ireland, yeah, also.
Northern Ireland.
And Gibraltar, because Gibraltar got to vote on it. Actually, and you know, it's not just Ireland. Sorry, not just London. It's also, you know, the other major cities were very much for remaining. But going back to identity and the kind of social psychology of national identity and how that works is that identities also experience trauma. For most Europeans, for those on the continent, that trauma was World War II. And while World War II was by all means not a cakewalk for the Brits, they were one of the very few European countries to say that they had never fallen or been occupied by the Nazis or their allies. Britain's moment of national trauma came years after the war. And this is going to set up the reasons why I would say the UK did begin turning toward Europe. We already covered Britain's declining relationship with its former dominions. But this is probably one of the biggest incidents of the post-war world that many people aren't aware of, but it really did a lot to define the international order after World War II. After World War II, we have this creation of the United Nations and the Security Council, the five nations that are tasked with being the guardians of world peace, who are probably the most unqualified to try to guarantee peace of any kind, but what the heck, here they are. The US, the Soviet Union, the UK, France, and China. China is a separate issue on this matter, but we're not going into that. But France and the UK were great powers before World War II. They were the major powers of the world, and the ones that were supposed to be the guarantors of the Versailles Peace. After World War II, first off, we begin the process of decolonization. This was a process that was born both of necessity and of pressure. Necessity because both Britain and France were economically devastated by the war, and they did not have the resources to continue to maintain their far-flung empires. The war also, especially in the case of the British Empire, awakened very strong feelings of national identity within those. It represented the final decision of the Commonwealth realms to, like Canada and Australia, to really seek their own fortunes in international policy because of their unique contributions to the war, like the Canadians in Sicily and the Australians in the Pacific Theater. Then you also have, for example, in India, that it cemented India's role as the bastion against Japan during the war, which also merited independence. Britain still had lots of smaller colonies at the time that it was responsible for. And so it and France, despite their colonies dropping left and right, still believed that they were fully equal to an extent to the United States and to the Soviet Union. And the crisis where this concept is shown to be completely and utterly false is the Suez Crisis. Mm. And this was a crisis that took place under the premiership of Anthony Eden. So you have, during World War II, the prime minister for most of World War II, the great hero of World War II in many minds, is Sir Winston Churchill. His deputy prime minister from Labour succeeded him as prime minister, Clement Attlee. And both of these two are considered to be among the greatest prime ministers, not only of the 20th century, but of British history in general. Attlee lost the 1951 election. Churchill became prime minister again. By now, Churchill is an old man, and people finally began to notice that. I'm pretty sure that Churchill was an old man during World War I, so I don't know why anyone was surprised. But his health was declining, so he stepped aside, and his chosen successor, his groomed successor, was Sir Anthony Eden, who was foreign secretary under Churchill, both during World War II and during Churchill's second government. Eden was very much convinced of Britain's still global role and power and reach. And the French had some concept of that as well. So the Suez Crisis arose because an Egyptian nationalist, Nasser, nationalized the Suez Canal. Also, earlier than that, he had overthrown, the monarchy in Egypt, which was basically a British puppet. So he wasn't really a friend to the Brits leading up to this. But the Suez Crisis was significant because you had Britain, France, using assistance from Israel, basically launched an invasion of Egypt to try to seize control of the canal. Now, certainly Britain, France, and Israel combined would be able to defeat Egypt in a war. But what no one in those three capitals, or three countries expected, was that the U.S. under Eisenhower and the Soviet Union would both issue an ultimatum to the Brits, the French, and the Israelis to withdraw, or it would be war. This was a major blow to the psyches of both countries in many ways. France's blow was probably mitigated by the fact that it had worse blows to come with the loss of Algeria in the offing. But for the Brits, it was a huge blow. It was hugely a huge psychological trauma. Simultaneous to much of this happening was the foundation of the European Coal and Steel Community. This is the ancestor of the European Union. It's really hard to imagine that, you know, the political and economic organization that controls, that you, brings much of Europe together right now, began its life as a coal and steel community. But it did. It included six countries: France, Germany, Italy, and the three Low Countries. Britain was invited to join. Britain was like, nah, we have an empire. It wasn't quite so flippant as that, but Britain did still believe that it had better options elsewhere. Suez revealed that not to be the case. Suez revealed several things. One, that it was not an equal partner in the special relationship with America. It revealed that its empire was gone. Suez marked the real nail in that coffin. One might have thought India's independence would have been, but no, Suez was the key deciding factor there. Also, it was clear to those in London that even if they'd wanted to call the Americans on their statement, they were not going to receive the support of the Dominion realms, Canada, Australia, etc. So it was such a huge blow to the British psyche. It brought Anthony Eden's government down. You know, a man who'd been groomed for prime minister for the better part of a decade gets into office, mucks it up, and he's gone within the space of one parliament. And his successors, his conservative successors, would make it their mission to find Britain's fortune in better and closer ties to Europe. And they would aim to join the European community.
Does seeking your fortunes in Europe for Britain actually make them European in that sense? Because it seems like they're going there mostly because they're out of options.
Well, like I said, the Brits never... Churchill, Attlee, Eden, even on down to Thatcher, fiercely believed in Britain's place as a European country. They firmly believed that. Now, what that identity meant in terms of interaction with the other European states is a separate matter. But I think that the only people who would argue that Britain is not European are extreme weird little Englanders or UKIPers. But for most Tories, for certainly Labour, Liberal Democrats, and for the parties like the SNP and Plaid Cymru, Britain and the peoples of Britain are Europeans. But it's the question of the strength of that identity, and what does that identity then, how does that identity inform decisions or policy? That is the bigger question. Britain. The question, though, that you asked, now I think of it, does create an interesting issue, because the Brits aren't the only ones who may have struggled with the question of whether or not Britain is a European country. Because Harold Macmillan, who, after weird British Tory party drama, becomes prime minister, his first goal is to then decide to bring Britain into the European community. And he is thwarted twice by a certain Charles de Gaulle, who by now was president of France, and was convinced that the Brits would be nothing more than American pawns in Europe to sabotage it. De Gaulle could be a bit paranoid, but I could also understand why, because de Gaulle was treated very appallingly by both Churchill and Roosevelt during the war, and he was treated even worse by Truman. So American statesmen did very little to endear themselves to France's great liberator.
Oh, country boy from Missouri doesn't like a Frenchman? Who would have guessed?
Well, I mean, it was part of France. You'd think that'd be at least... Anyway, very long time ago, I know. But yeah, it... de Gaulle vetoed British membership in the European community twice because of his speculation that Britain is not truly European or committed to the project. And so the European Union, up to that point, had been driven by cooperation between France and, at the time, West Germany. That was the it was basically a Franco-German mortar, which on which the European project hinged. And I think that it's important to note that one of the big arguments for the European Union and its role has been not merely economic, but that it has actually prevented a major war from breaking out on the European continent. You know, whereas world wars were started and fought and lost and millions died because of these ancient rivalries between the Germans and the French and whatnot, the notion now of a war between France and Germany or a war among any set of European powers within the European Union that would create devastation on the scale of the world wars is unthinkable. So in that respect, the European Union has been a great success. It is certainly flawed. It is definitely flawed. But at least in an auxiliary kind of peacekeeping sense, it has worked. I think also, you know, when we get to the question of whether or not Britain should be in the European community or the European Union, it was never a question of what this meant for British identity vis-a-vis European identity. That was never really a question. When Edward Heath, who was a conservative prime minister in the early 1970s, when he actually succeeded in getting Britain into the European community, and it's important to remember, it was the conservatives who actually managed to achieve this. Labour at the time were very much the party of Eurosceptics at the time. When we look at it was a conservative party that took Britain into the EEC. But the party that had its big divisions over Europe at this time wasn't the Conservative Party. It was the Labour Party. For those who do not know, or if the name doesn't give it away for some reason, the Labour Party is technically a socialist party. It is a member of the Socialist International grouping of socialist parties. Its symbol for a long time was a red flag. It's now a red rose. Their anthem is the people's flag. Now, sometimes one might wonder how socialist labor is when you look at people like Tony Blair, but we'll leave him out of this for the time being. Labor was very much split up because it viewed, because at the time Europe, well, the European community was an economic union. The political dimension was still in the offing. They viewed the European economic community as a vehicle for capitalism, specifically laissez-faire capitalism. And that might be part of why Tories were attracted to it at the time and why socialists and some other leftists were skeptical of it. Harold Wilson, who was a Labour prime minister both before and after Ted Heath, held a referendum on whether or not Britain should stay in the European Union. His cabinet was split on the matter. Some of his most notable cabinet figures campaigned to leave. Some campaigned to stay. It was very bitter to an extent. And the country voted on a 2-1 margin to stay. And so they stayed. A few years go by. Harold Wilson resigns because he thought he was getting too old. He turned 60. If he could see our Congress, he might have some retirement advice. He resigned. His successor, Jim Callaghan, who was also pro-European, became prime minister. But he fell from power in 1979 and was replaced with that great pro-European, the person who did the most to help shape the European Union as it is now, Margaret Thatcher. Yes, I mean that Margaret Thatcher, the same one who famously said no, no, no to the euro. A big part of the way the European Union is today is because of Margaret Thatcher, which is something I really like to remind right-wingers about.
Oh, Maggie.
Margaret Thatcher, I think, best exemplifies never thought I would say that, but I think that she best exemplifies a big part of the dilemma of what it is to be British in Europe. Margaret Thatcher believed in a European economic community. She believed in the common market. She believed in the customs union. And as, you know, a laissez-faire capitalist like Margaret Thatcher, that makes sense. break down trade barriers, unshackle business. Mm-hmm. Everyone, you should read Friedrich Hayek or whatever. That was the Europe that she envisaged. And she also, however, firmly believed in not merely British identity. Margaret Thatcher was very much a believer in diversity. She believed that the unique identities of the European community at the time, be it French or Italian or Dutch or German or... does Belgian count? Sure. But they all mattered and they all contributed to something greater. And she did express fears on occasion of a European identity that simply melted and dissolved and broke all of these down, in which instead of a rainbow, for example, you have a mush. To be clear, she wasn't like some, you know, nationalist racial purist, but she believed that cultures were valuable as they were and they contributed something to a greater whole in that form. And I think that she does have a certain amount of a point there. The irony is, for all of Thatcher's beliefs in sovereignty and the nation within Europe, she's also the prime minister that handed away the power of member states to veto certain actions by the European Communities Commission and by the presidency. Because nations at the time had vetoes over pretty much anything, she considered that to be inhibiting progress. And so I think that Margaret Thatcher has learned a lesson that many in our generation and time need to remember, is just because the power to do something you like exists, that power can be done to do things you don't like. So you should either accept that or not be very fond of that power. That's something I'd throw out there.
Yeah, yeah. So to wrap this back up, bringing it back to the present a bit, I remember a little while ago, probably late last year, I saw a video on YouTube from a YouTuber named Explain. He does etymology, and he did sort of the etymology of the term Brexit. And he pointed out some, I think, was sort of an interesting look at the term. And that is Brexit, you know, meaning British or Britain exit from the European Union. And he pointed out the fact that the term Britain means England, Wales, and it's sort of with an exclusion of Scotland. You know, Great Britain would include Scotland, England, and Wales, if you're looking at this etymology. And so when you say Brexit, British or Britain exit, then he looked at the map of where all people were voting in. It looked like, yeah, that vote just might be that because it was Wales and England that very overwhelmingly voted to leave, while Scotland and then Northern Ireland didn't.
And Gibraltar. I think that, you know, just to run a bit, you know, with this, is that the growth of national identity, especially the real explosion of greater interest either in independence or in self-government in the non-English parts of the United Kingdom, has interestingly intersected to an extent with the European Union, with the question of the European Union. But on the other hand, let me just go back to Thatcher. Mm-hmm. And why? Because Thatcher is a revolutionary figure in British politics, and global politics too, but especially in British politics, in that it was under her that the Tories became the Eurosceptic Party. Labour, which had earlier in the 1980s, actually literally split into two parties because of Europe. There was the Rump Labour Party that still had fat pro-European, anti-European mm-hmm. factions, and then very ardently pro-Europeans left and formed the Social Democratic Party. It exists now because it merged with the Liberals, mm-hmm. became the Liberal Democrats. But Europe also began to develop its political function during this time. So things like the Workers' Charter, Continental Standards for Workers' Rights, did gradually win socialist groupings over mm-hmm. to Europe across throughout not only the UK, but also on the continent. There were some in the UK that never really gave up their Euroscepticism. Incidentally, one of those was Jeremy Corbyn, who is now the leader of the Labour Party, And for anyone who's been watching how the parliamentary response to Brexit has been going might be pulling their hair out. I actually have a large bald spot on one side of my head now because of it. But this set up the notion as well with Labour and the Liberal Democrats being pro-European. Where in Labour's case it hadn't been before, the Tories now more ambivalent or even in some cases hostile toward Europe, that there was this kind of political square dance that happened where increasingly people began to see the European Union as a left-wing organization, when really it's in a lot of ways it's apolitical. Politically, it has, well, it's not very democratic. There's that. Economically, it is very economically liberal, in that, you know, the official economic orthodoxy is very, very limited state intervention in the economies outside of what may have been in place when a country joined.
It is definitely very neoliberal, I think. Yeah,
we look at the worst example of that in terms of the ongoing plight of Greece, and to a lesser extent, the effects of austerity in places like Portugal, Italy, and Spain. But it's also interesting to note, though, that the European question has been such a complex one in British politics and history that it has been the political death of three prime ministers. It was Europe that caused the Tories to turn on Margaret Thatcher. It was Europe that destabilized her successor, John Major, and led to him losing the 1997 election to Tony Blair. And it was his decision to hold an in-out referendum and then losing it that drove David Cameron from office. And what we're seeing now is this kind of repeat of elements of the 1970s, 1980s, where the question of Europe has split both parties. Jeremy Corbyn, when he became leader of the Labour Party, had been a rebel. He was anti-European in a party that had been one of the most ardently European parties in British politics. And he leads a party that still clings on greatly to that. But, you know, when we look at the maps, and which you may not have seen in your own research, Grant, the many constituencies where Labour MPs come from voted for Brexit. Conversely, many Conservative constituencies where Conservative MPs may have voted to leave voted to remain. And so, you know, it's very interesting to see in the UK, not merely how the future is going to be shaped for Britain's relationship with Europe, you know, whether it's a hard or soft or anywhere in between Brexit. It's going to be how it impacts the political landscape of the UK in the coming years.
The future is foggy at the moment, but then again, they're used to that.
Well, the Brits are certainly used to it.
Yeah, so I think that's a good place to wrap it up here. We've got a lot of questions that, unfortunately, we can't answer here. Time is going to have to answer those.
Yeah, I think, honestly, this is a question that could dominate the minds of academics for years to come.
Oh, yeah. It's one of the big questions that'll come from historians asking about 2016 for very long time. How was everyone wrong? I think that's the ultimate question every historian's going to have to answer about 2016, 100 years from now, was why was everybody wrong?
I think pollsters need to ask that question too. Mm-hmm. Really need to ask that question.